We think of the Christmas story beginning with the angel Gabriel appearing to Mary, right, and telling her that she will be the mother of God. But the story stretches far, far back into the history of God's people and the deep hope that they had for the Messiah to come and establish God's reign on earth, of peace on earth. It begins with the promise of the prophet that in the fullness of time this would be so. But in the meantime, God's people waited through the faithfulness and faithlessness of their kings and the horrors of exiles and the difficulties of their return to a devastated land after the exile. And now, the story is beginning to pick up steam through the time of their occupation by this world power, this world empire of Rome. And all throughout, through the ups and the downs, they continued to pray and to worship. And at the center of their worship and identity as God's holy people was the Jerusalem Temple. The Jerusalem Temple, with its gleaming white walls, was one of the most beautiful buildings in antiquity. The temple's large precincts included outer courts and the sacred inner court of the priests. The court of the priests contained the bronze altar of burnt offerings, okay? The altar of burnt offerings on which lambs were sacrificed night and day. This court was directly in front of the temple sanctuary, with its impressive portico and huge double doors. A large oil lamp was suspended above those doors, which was kept burning continuously to signify the presence of God in his temple. Now, inside that sanctuary, as you went through those doors, inside the sanctuary, were two places, the holy place and the holy of holies. These sacred spaces contained the sacred furniture that God had commanded Moses to replicate from what he saw in the heavenly sanctuary. Can you kind of get the picture here? And it was this magnificent temple. Inside the sanctuary, there was a lamp, which we have, continuously burning. You'll hear echoes of what some of the few things that we have to this day. But we have a lamp that is kept continuously burning to signify the presence of God in the Eucharist. This was a large lamp kept burning continuously, right, to signify the presence of God in his temple, in the Holy of Holies. But in the holy place, there were the two places, the holy place and the Holy of Holies. The holy place contained a golden altar of incense. And that golden altar of incense would burn the incense that would take the prayers of the people up into the heavenly realms. Let me back up a little bit. Within the first sacred space known as that holy place, in the center of the room, to the right side, was the golden table that held the bread of the presence of God. Across from the table, on the left side, was the menorah, a golden lampstand, whose burning oil lamp signified the presence of God's Spirit. And at the far end of the room was this golden altar of incense that I've already told you about. Okay, there would be a designated priest who would burn that incense every day. It was a once-in-a-lifetime honor to be chosen to be the one designated to enter the holy place and burn the incense. That would happen maybe once in the lifetime of a priest. Why am I telling you all this? Because on this occasion, that designated lot, fell to to Zacharias. He was elderly enough. He was an old man by the time this happened to him. He may well have thought that his temple service was close to being over. Because you could go your entire lifetime and never, never be chosen to enter the holy place and bring the incense. The lot fell to him. And it is here, at the golden altar of incense, in the holy place of the temple sanctuary, that our Christmas story begins to take dramatic form. So Zechariah, as all priests, was a descendant of Aaron. Now, Aaron founded the Hebrew priesthood. He, along with his brother Moses, helped lead the people out of slavery. His wife, Elizabeth, was also a direct descendant of Aaron. So this was a couple steeped in priestly lore and in the stories and history of their people. And being both from the line of Aaron, they were, in a sense, they were kind of the Jewish upper crust royalty. Okay? They were probably also pretty well off. They lived in Ein Kerem, which was a village about 4 miles outside of Jerusalem, and twice a year they would go into Jerusalem so that Zechariah could do his week-long rotation as a priest in the temple. The Gospel of Luke tells us that they were upright before God. They conducted themselves impeccably in the commandments and ordinances of the Lord. However, the Gospel says, they had no child because Elizabeth was barren. And both were well advanced in their days. One can only imagine how deeply and persistently they had prayed for a child, not only because a child is wonderful to have, but because children were considered the preeminent blessing of the Lord. And being barren pretty much meant that you had done something grievously wrong. There was something very wrong with you. And it made you, especially the woman, a target of delusion. So now it is, this lovely couple has gone to fulfill their rotation. And it is, and the lot has fallen to Zechariah, not only to do his rotation as a priest, but to be the one to go in to the holy place and offer the incense. So do you want to hear how they did that? It's pretty cool, isn't it? Okay, so remember in the court of the priests, right, outside the sanctuary, there's this bronze altar of sacrifice. So the sacrifice of an animal. So the animal is burning there, and you would take a coal from that altar, the altar of sacrifice, and carry it into the sanctuary to light the fire at the golden altar of incense. So there would be two priests helping Zacharias to do this. Two priests to get the coals from the sacrificial altar, carry them in. They would light the fire, and then they would leave. And then there would be, the choir, the orchestra would begin their chorus of praise. The people who would be gathered would recite the first line of every psalm while this incense is offered. And the incense carries the smoke of the incense, right? Carries the prayers of all the people up to God, the prayers of both thanksgiving and repentance. Pretty dramatic. Pretty dramatic. Pretty awesome. And on this particular occasion, there is even greater drama. Because after he places the incense on the altar, Zechariah was startled by a sudden movement. Turning, he saw an angelic being standing to the right of the altar of incense. And seeing him, Zechariah was alarmed, the Bible says. Was alarmed, and fear descended upon him. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zacharias. Do not be afraid, for your supplication has been heard. And your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall declare his name John. And for you there will be joy and great delight, and many will rejoice at his birth. And he will go forth in the Lord's presence, in the power and the spirit of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children, and to turn the wayward to the wisdom of the upright, and to prepare a people made ready for the Lord." And Zechariah said exactly what you or I, or pretty much anyone you know, would say when something has happened that is completely beyond imagining. How could I know this? In what way shall I know this? And then he gets rational, which you know you mean too, and he says, you know, I am very advanced in age, and my wife is getting on as well. Well, this is how he learns how not to talk to an angel. Because then he finds out exactly who this angelic being is. It is Gabriel. It is Gabriel, who only appears 3 times by name in the scriptures. Once, the first time in the Hebrew scriptures to Daniel to reveal the meaning of his troubling visions of the end times, and to point towards the anointed one, the Messiah. And now to him, Zechariah, announcing the child who will prepare his people for the coming of the Lord. And the third time will be, can you guess who the third time is? To Mary, to announce that the one is here, the anointed one is coming. So, how can I know this? Zechariah says to the angel, and in reply, the angel says to him, "I am Gabriel. I am Gabriel, who stand before the presence of God, and I was sent to speak to you and announce these good tidings to you. See then, you shall be silent and unable to speak until the day that these things take place, because you did not trust my words, which will be fulfilled at their proper time." Now, silence for a time is not such a bad thing. It gave Zacharias time to truly ponder what was happening to him, to his wife, and to their people, for the world. This incredible thing that they had hoped and dreamed for so many years was actually happening. God was answering the prayers of all his people, all those prayers for the Messiah to come and redeem them, offered up day and night as the incense wafted up to heaven. All those prayers whispered in the night times of fear and deprivation. All those sighs of longing, all those hopes and dreams for the shalom, the peace of God. This elderly man, this priest of a long lineage of priests, had over 9 months to contemplate the history of his people, the history of God's faithfulness, and time to listen. To listen to the daily happenings of Ayin Karim, the village where he lived. To listen to the morning and evening prayers. To listen to his own heartbeat, his own breath. To listen to his wife. To listen to God. So over 9 months, you know, his silence prepared him in a way that nothing else could. to welcome this miracle baby, who was not the anointed one, but who was to point the way, to get his people ready for the anointed one. And Zechariah's song, so when the baby is born, and he's holding this newborn baby, the hearty cries of his baby boy that they had hoped and prayed for all those years, when he can speak again, the first thing out of Zechariah's mouth is a song of praise and prediction. Zechariah's song, recorded in Luke's Gospel, has been highly beloved in the church and has for centuries been known as the Benedictus. The lyrics of that song that we sang between the reading that Mitchell gave us, the first reading, and the second reading from Philippians, the lyrics of that song come from this Benedictus, from Zechariah's song. The first thing out of his mouth, blessed be the God of Israel, because he has visited his people and bought their liberation, to work mercy with our fathers and to remember his covenant, his holy covenant, the oath he swore to Abraham our father, to grant that we, having been delivered without fear from our enemies' hands, might worship him in holiness and justice before his presence all our days. And now you, little child, will be called a prophet of the Most High. For you go forth before the presence of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give to his people a knowledge of salvation and the forgiveness of their sins, through our God's inmost mercy, whereby a dawning from on high will visit us, to shine upon those sitting in darkness and death's shadow, and so to guide our feet into the way and into the path of peace. It is on this second Sunday of Advent that we light this candle of peace. This candle of peace, it's not the absence of conflict or trouble. Nothing about John's life was absent of conflict or trouble. Nothing in Jesus' life was absent of conflict or trouble. But this peace, this path of peace that Zechariah sang of and that we light the candle for, this is the peace that arises out of persistent prayer. It's the kind of prayer that Zechariah and Elizabeth embodied, even when they had completely lost any hope that their prayers would actually be fulfilled. Continued to pray. It's the kind of peace that comes from a new revelation of God's inmost mercy, a mercy that doesn't depend upon the highly stylized rituals or the beauty of magnificent buildings, but that is revealed in the tender flesh of a newborn child, and that has been revealed in the faithfulness, in this faithfulness of an elderly couple. May this peace, this path of peace that dawns upon us, shine in our hearts now and for the rest of our days. Amen.